Sure enough, the first full day with the new car, and I have to take my wife's Pontiac G6 down to Maturi Pavilion. Why? I don't quite know how to park our new monstrosity, and her car, to be quite honestly, fits in better places, especially when you get there an hour and 15 minutes early, and the lot in front of the pavilion is already full. Yep, it's a Sunday in college wrestling, and we've got some real fun stuff to discuss. I'm Jason Bryant, and this is Short Time Shots, a look at the day's happenings in college wrestling from around the world, or at least the United States. I don't have any funny anecdotes to share today. Half of the time, they're not even that funny anyway, other than, my fantasy football teams suck, like bad, horrible. Hashtag, no one cares about your fantasy team. There is truth in that statement, especially mine. I'll start off today at the duel I was at as number 4 Oklahoma State pulled away from number 13 Minnesota 23-9 in front of over 3,000 at Maturi Pavilion. We saw two highly anticipated matchups on the day and 5 overall that featured both competitors in the national rankings. After an uneventful Cowboy win at 125 pounds, it was kind of a snoozer with Piccinini and Sean Russell, but Dayton Fix of Oklahoma State knocked off Minnesota's two-time All-American and previous NCAA finalist Ethan Lizak 6-1 at 133. Lizak is every bit of 133, and this new weight class should, and most likely will continue to serve him well, other than today. Dixon Lizak got involved in some fun scrambles, but a pair of takedowns and a reversal helped give the Cowboy redshirt freshman the W. I talked with Fix and a bunch of Gophers on the Guillotine Grapevine, which you can also find on the Mat Talk Podcast Network. Bonus wins by Chandler Rogers, Jacoby Smith, and Dakota Gear allowed the Cowboys to pull ahead. And even after a lost team point at 133 pounds, the Cowboys really weren't in trouble after the break. Minnesota did give their fans something to cheer about as Gable Steveson's first home duel was a big W as he used a first period takedown and a set of 4 near fall points to top All-American Derek White 8-2 at 285 pounds. Again, we'll hear from Gable, Eggum, that's Brandon Eggum, Fix and Mitch McKee, who finally beat Cade Brock in a folk-style match, and a match that was worth the price of admission. These two just go and go and go and go, and Mitch McKee finally got the victory there in folk-style over Cade Brock. He's had some great comebacks in freestyle over the years. Those two really just throw everything, the washer, the dryer, the kitchen sink, and maybe even the water softener while they're at it. Number 2, Ohio State had no Myles Martin and no Kollin Moore, but the Buckeyes had enough to beat Arizona State 22-17 in Tempe. Zahid Valencia of ASU beat TeShan Campbell at 174 pounds, while Micah Jordan registered a solid 18-8 major decision over Josh Maruca at 149. Lineups weren't exactly 100% for either team, but number 5, Michigan top number 6, Lehigh 21-13 at Chrysler. That's arena, not the car. At 174, Myles Amine dropped Jordan Kutler 6-4 at 174. Yes, that's redundancy. And really, that's the only matchup that really had ranked wrestlers, because as I said, at 174, Amine tops Kutler 6-4 at 174. Yeah, that's just bad writing, Dickie. We did have an injury default with Malik Amine dropping a match to Jimmy Hoffman, and then Lehigh's Jordan Wood majoring Luke Reddy at heavyweight. Other than that, nothing really riveting, other than this match was supposed to be wrestled on Friday, but snow moved it to Sunday. As what we call that in Minnesota, Friday. Virginia Tech will limp home to Blacksburg after taking 2 losses on the road this weekend. After losing at Missouri the other day, number 25 Northwestern used a major decision at heavyweight by Conan Jennings to knock off the 10th-ranked Hokies 20-16 in Evanston. Key match there came at 149 pounds where Shayne Oster upended Ryan Blees in the tiebreaker. Number 12 Nebraska top number 18 Wyoming 22-12 in Laramie. Couple of interesting results there on both sides. First, Zeke Moisey was upended by Wyoming's Cole Verner at 125, and then Tucker Sjomeling, who was just beaten the other night by Jens Lantz of Wisconsin. Well, Sjomeling beats All-American Montorie Bridges 13-11. Ay, 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 Dios mio! Bumblebee guy, Simpsons, whatever. Insert cartoon stereotype that offends people here. Branson Ashworth beat Nebraska's Isaiah White 2-0 at 165. And Nebraska, they picked up 7 wins, but they did lose with the NCAA finalist and a past Division II champ. Go figure. Wacky. Number 17, Wisconsin had redshirt freshman Trent Hillger play some heroics on 2 occasions on Sunday. First against Princeton, Hilger earned a first-period technical fall to push the Badgers past the Tigers 22-18. A few hours later, an overtime win over Tate Orndorff lifted Wisconsin past number 21 Utah Valley 22-17. We'll get to the tournaments here in a sec, but we did have some D3 action to get around to. John Carroll went 5-0 on the day as it hosted the JCU Duals along with D2, D3, and NAIA teams. The Blue Streaks, and we don't need Martin Lawrence. Martin Lawrence. Yeah, no shenanigans. Anyway, where was I? Yeah, John Carroll, the Blue Streaks beat Urbana, Waynesburg, Lords, Pitt, Bradford, and Penn State. Penn State Barron. That's a Division III school up in Erie. Speaking of Urbana, the first-year Division II program earned its first win in school history by defeating another first-year program, Pitt Bradford. So somebody was going to get their first win. Trevor Hankins' technical fall at 184 pounds clinched the duel for another colored mascot. It's the Blue Knights. We had the Blue Streaks. Now we got the Blue Knights, who are coached by Seton Hill alum Brett Smith. Okay, tournament time, and that's where top-ranked Penn State rolled. One media professional, who shall remain nameless, told me earlier on Sunday that he appreciates how Penn State helps move a tournament along. Yeah, if Brock Lesnar welcomes people to Suplex City, then Penn State Wrestling needs to... Wait, Pittsburgh is already calling itself Pinsburg. So, hey, Penn State fans, let's come up with some type of name for Penn State that is some type of geographical marker, like city or town, or maybe I can get my friend Nate Shy, the mayor of Bringtown, he can come up with something. So Penn State won the tournament for a third straight year, scored 192 points, and had eight champions. The only weights they didn't win were 125 and 149. They had a guy in the finals at 149. More on that in a minute. Drexel was second with 109.5 and five runners-up. Roman Bravo, Young Nick Lee, Jason Nolf, Vincenzo Joseph, Mark Hall, Shakur Rashid, Bo Nickel, and Anthony Kassar. Those were your champions. Two things might have gotten sorted out with the Penn State lineup. Brady Berge beat Jared Verclaren at 149 in a tight one before Berge would medically forfeit in the finals at 149. Yeah, Kassar beat Nick Nevels convincingly in the semis at 285. And, like I said in the very first episode of the Short Time Wrestling Podcast, depth is never a bad thing. There isn't much in the way of ranked roadblocks in those finals, but Kassar did have a solid major decision over Drexel's Joey Goodhart. Hey, Lancaster kid! In the finals, by the way, I had a house in Lancaster. I used to live in Lancaster. Good place. Lock Haven won the Black Knight Invitational. The Black Knight always triumphs. I really don't have anything else to add other than I just like saying that Monty Python line. NC State did not see much in the way of super crazy battles at the Wolfpack Open, but Tariq Wilson did beat Zach Sherman of North Carolina in the finals at 133. Best individual final of the New York State Intercollegiate Championships was at heavyweight, where a pair of Division III All-Americans mixed it up. It was Oneonta State's James Bethel came away with the title, beating Ithaca's Jake O'Brien 5-1. Bethel was a D3 runner-up a year ago. That guy likes to pin the crap out of people. Not, like, literally the crap out of people. That would be kind of messy. But let's just say Bethel, the kid, likes to finish matches before they get to 7 minutes. He's pretty good. North Dakota State won five titles at the Roadrunner Open. Stanford freshman Shane Griffith, who's still redshirting, was impressive in winning the title at 165. Menlo's Terrell Sidner, that guy, keep an eye on him in the NAI. He won at 149, beating high school phenom Jaden Abbas and junior world teamer, yes, Peyton Omania of Michigan State on his way to gold. The Missouri Valley Open took place in Marshall, Missouri for the women on Sunday. Marshall, as we know, according to Matt.com, a nice community. There were plenty of notables. Sarah Allen of the University of Cumberland's top Wayland Baptist junior world medalist Asia Ray, the second period fall at 101 pounds. McKendry's Felicity Taylor registered a solid title and a fall over Michaela Welsh of King to win gold at 116. Brenda Rainey of McKendry topped returning WCWA champion Andrew Beth Rivera of Campbellsville by fall to claim top honors at 130. Rivera had beaten Allie Haupt in the semis, while Rainey had topped Erin Harpio of Sunkist in her semi. Junior world champion Maya Nelson mixed it up with the college kids as that Sunkist kids team representative topped fellow Colorado native Ashlyn Ortega of King 11-1. That's a technical superiority in the freestyle world. In the finals, Ortega topped NYC RTC's Bree Santos, a Virginia kid, in the semifinals there. Anna Naylor of the University of the Cumberland's won a 7-7 criteria final over McKendry's Jasmine Bailey at 155, while veteran Brandy Lowe, who seems to have been around forever, I think she might have been around when the WCW started. No, okay, she's not been around that long. It just seems like she's been around for a while. She gave McKendry another title with an 8-2 win over Alex Castillo of Campbellsville in the finals at 191. As always, all those scores and more in the nation's most comprehensive college wrestling scoreboard at almanac.mattalkonline.com. Contribute and say thanks with a small monthly contribution at mattalkonline.com/join the team. The kids are off from school this week. We'll have some shakeups in the rankings this week in the coaches poll, and I'm going to go watch Spaceballs. Here it is, sir. Spaceballs. We're at now. Yeah. Anyway, I love that line. I'd like to thank you for spending your time with me, because you've always got time for short time. Corporal, get me the video cassette of Spaceballs the movie. That's all I got. I could watch that movie on mute, by the way. I'm that guy. The Short Time Wrestling Podcast is proudly outfitted by Compound Clothing. Shirts, singlets, custom gear orders, everything you need. Call up Cliff and the crew at cmpteamwear.com. If you've made it this far, I'm guessing you like the show. Well, why don't you subscribe if you haven't done so already by going to mattalkonline.com/listen. That'll give you a list of various different ways that you can subscribe and listen to the show for free, whether it be Apple Podcasts, your Android app. This show has an app for its own self on iOS and Android. And there's a bunch of other places you can find this show by going to mattalkonline.com/listen. That's how you can listen each and every episode. Thanks for listening. Now go subscribe.